It's so great to see so many of you guys here. And like I said at the other panel, you have choices of where to be. I think you made the right choice to be in this room right now. Thank you. The topic, actually, first I want to say thank you to Gabby Armand, Aaron Bisman, Olivia Meyer, Shayna Penn, the crew here at the VLS room, Lee Mergner and Jazz Times for making Jazz Congress possible and this particular event. And the topic for today is jazz shrines. It's the idea that jazz history can be represented and maintained by actual historic markers. It's not a new one. There are statues of Miles Davis in a number of places, mostly Europe, and there's that statue of John Coltrane in High Point, North Carolina. But the idea of buildings being preserved, homes, houses, studios, this is a relatively new one in jazz. And we have three case studies we're going to look at, which are in various stages of development, and ask questions such as, which of these sacred spaces deserve this status? How do they get this status? What do we do with these sites once they've been preserved? And to help us discuss these questions, we have you here, and we do have the microphone available for you to join the discussion. And we also have a panel of experts who are now deep in the jazz shrine business. Each represents a venue, as I said, in different stages of development. And let me introduce them to you now. First, we have someone who comes to us from East St. Louis. She's a career educator specializing in early childhood education and is a member of a leading family in the East St. Louis community and served as executive assistant to the mayor of East St. Louis from 2007 to 15. She founded HOME, that's H-O-M-E, or House of Miles East St. Louis, and she's president of the organization as well. Please welcome Lauren Parks. And also visiting us from East St. Louis is the organization's vice president, Jazz Pearson. Jazz, thank you for being with us. We have with us also the Director of Research Collections for the Louis Armstrong House Museum and author of What a Wonderful World, The Magic of Louis Armstrong's Later Years. He is also a jazz pianist based out of Toms River, New Jersey. And while the Louis Armstrong House Museum continues to search for a new director, he'll be talking about that particular shrine in Queens. Ricky Riccardi, everyone. We also have with us a historic preservation specialist whose background includes a law degree from NYU and a certificate in historic preservation from Drew University. She has served on panels at New Jersey's State Historic Preservation Conferences and has worked as a reviewer for Bergen County History Grants. She has fought to preserve important historic structures in New York and New Jersey and is now leading the effort to list the Rudy Van Gelder Studio and Home on the state and national registers of historic places. Jennifer Rothschild. We also have a man who's known as much for his work preserving jazz compositions as he is for playing and producing jazz. In the 1980s, he created Dameronia with Philly Joe Jones, the tribute band, of course, to the music of Tad Dameron. He's worked extensively with artists such as Joe Henderson and has run Second Floor Music for decades, one of the most reliable repositories of jazz compositions. With his wife, Maureen, he now helps run the Rudy Van Gelder Studio, overseeing recording sessions, events, etc., in that famous space in Englewood Cliffs, New Jersey. Don Sickler. And I do want to point out that though she's not up here on the panel, we have her here in spirit. We need to also give credit to her being here with us today, not just in spirit. She's Don's better half, and for many years, she worked tirelessly at the side of Rudy Van Gelder, and in fact was the only assistant that famous jazz engineer allowed himself to have. Maureen Sickler, everyone. So to get the conversation started, I asked each of our panelists to prepare something, a video, couple of images, and to explain how they got involved in this game, what they're doing, and what's going on. And I thought I would, why don't we start with the sights and sounds of the Louis Armstrong House, Ricky.
Let's do it. Armstrong moved here in 1943, and he was here the last 20 years of his life. He actually died in his home in 1971. My name is Ricky Riccardi. I'm the Director of Research Collections for the Louis Armstrong House Museum, sometimes known as Wikipedia for my Armstrong obsessions, but really and truly, I am all Armstrong all the time. We have about 750 reel-to-reel tapes that Louis made in the last 20 years of his life, and a lot of those tapes were made in this room. He would record himself practicing. He would dub his LPs to tape. Sometimes he would act as a disc jockey and address an imaginary audience.
That's my story, folks. I guess I'm stuck with it. I usually say nice things also about human beings if they deserve it. I never want to be any more than I am, and what I don't have, I don't need it anywho. I've always loved and I always lived a normal life, which I appreciate very much, and I've always loved everybody, still do.
We even have one tape where he gets into a pretty vicious argument with his wife, Lucille, and she doesn't know he's tape recording it.
Go to bed, I'll be there. Right behind you. And turn your television, your finger machine, you go, now what the shit, you got that fucking thing on? Hey.
Honey, where you going?
Turn your red tape recorder on. I'll be flopping me off.
I got thousands of tapes.
I wouldn't give a shit about your thousands of tapes. You can come with them tomorrow. Turn your tape off. In fact, erase out some of that shit.
You're getting nervous, huh?
I ain't getting nervous, but you ain't, you know, you ain't got no better
That's
sense
for
of
posterity.
Posterity, my ass. You got no better sense to play that for some of your, not even friends, somebody that come in here that you don't even know.
To me, that for posterity, that's the whole reason we have a house museum, the whole reason we have the research collections at Queens College. Armstrong, as unassuming and humble and down home as he was, knew what he had to endure, knew what he conquered, poverty, racism, you name it, to break down these barriers, to change the sound of music, and he wanted to be in control of his own story.
So we were buds, adjusted. Oh, you part of me still. Oh, yes, for you were my thrill. Yes. On Blueberry Hill,
There wouldn't be a Louis Armstrong House Museum without Lucille Armstrong. She was the fourth Mrs. Armstrong. She was in show business. She was a cotton club dancer. Actually, the first dark-skinned dancer hired by the Cotton Club, the usually only hired light-skinned African-American woman. Lucille married Louis in October 1942. In March 1943, she found out that there was this home for sale, 3456 107th Street in Corona. She moved in, she put the down payment down, she moved her mother in, got the house all situated. Louis was on tour for about six more months, and she never told him. It's not a very lavish home, but it was more than Armstrong ever had since he was raised in such poverty in New Orleans, and he ended up living here for the next 28 years of his life.
Ever since we married, we've been right there in that block, and everybody keeps their little homes up like we do.
And it's just like one big family, and they're all with their children, grandchildren. They come back to see Uncle Sesmo and Aunt Lucille.
Is there anything you'd like to add, Ricky? That's a great little piece.
Yeah, I mean, my biggest takeaway is I need to buy a new shirt and tie. I'm getting too much mileage out of this. Yeah. show of hands, how many people have been to the Louis Armstrong House Museum? How many people have not been? Let's see the other. Oh, we open tomorrow, 10 o'clock. I'll meet you there. Red 7 train, it's about 40 minutes from here. You have no excuse. Thank you. I did not pay him to say that.
Right. That's great. How about we move back way over to East St. Louis, and let's see that video, and we'll hear from Lauren after that.
Miles Davis is one of the most innovative, influential, and respected figures in the history of music. He is a timeless genius whose restless musical exploration made him a hero to many. Congress unanimously honored Kind of Blue by the passing of House Resolution 894, reaffirming the work as a national treasure. House of Miles East St. Louis is a non-profit 501c3 that provides educational enrichment opportunities at the restored East St. Louis childhood home of musician extraordinaire Miles Davis. The House of Miles East St. Louis provides educational enrichment opportunities for children and visitors of all ages. Exhibits, educational experiences, and innovative programs, both cultural and historical, celebrate our past, explore our present, and enrich our future. Programs offered at home are Mudagrees, which is a social and emotional learning program through the use of shelter dogs. The Garden and Healthy Living Program is a cultivation and engagement of plants and other forms of nature, and also physical fitness. The Arts is an expression of creative skills and imagination, producing works to be appreciated for their beauty and emotional power. Home, the House of Miles, East St. Louis.
Lauren, thank you so much for putting that together.
You're quite welcome. And of course, everyone in this room knows that everything about Miles is cool, right? The way he talked, the way he dressed, the way he stood holding that trumpet. So at House of Miles East St. Louis, we are cool as well. C-O-O-L. Want everybody to put up a C for constantly. Want everyone to say constantly.
Constantly.
O, operating.
Operating.
O, on.
On.
Love.
Love.
That's our cool. So we welcome everyone to East St. Louis, Illinois, your next time in the mighty Midwest. Come check us out. I see a couple of people that have been to House of Miles. Brian is a New Yorker. He's been to visit us. If anyone else has been there, spread the word and come check us out.
You know, I think we just need to put a date on this, too, that you've accomplished this in just the last 2-3 years. 2016, right? Was when you started to restore what was a house in disrepair.
Absolutely. So on the video, you saw a brief snippet of the home when we acquired it. And that was, we started in 2015, actively renovating the home. The home had been boarded up for about 15 years. So imagine not cleaning your home for 15 years, what the home looked like. So we jumped in with our love, with wonderful volunteers. We had a structural assessment conducted on the home, and the engineering firm graciously donated their services. The home was structurally sound. So that was the great news. So we jumped in with our personal funds. That's one of the number one questions we get. How did you fund a project of that nature? For phase one, we started with our personal funds and a very generous donation from my mother, who's a huge supporter. We had wonderful volunteers, and we jumped in with both feet, and we opened in 2016. And we're embarking this spring on phase two, three, and four, because not only, as I mentioned to Ashley, we own the home that Miles grew up in. And let me want to definitely specify, and many of you probably know this, he was born in Alton, Illinois, which is a little river town about 25 minutes from East St. Louis. His dad, of course, was a dental surgeon, and they moved to East St. Louis when Miles was a young boy. So the home that we have is where he spent his formative years before moving to New York in 1944. So we are getting ready to embark on phase two, and phase two includes a lower level where Miles formed his first high school band. So we plan to renovate that and for public consumption as well. Phase three and four includes outdoor staging. We have a lot of events. We host a lot of events at House of Miles East St. Louis. So we will be incorporating outdoor staging as well. And not only do we own the home, as I mentioned earlier, we own about 10 parcels around the home that leave wonderful opportunities for expansion.
That's great. Yeah. Thank you. I should also add that Lauren and Home are operating with the full support of the Miles Davis Estate. And in fact, it was Vince Wilburn, who runs the Miles Estate with Aaron Davis, who put us in touch in the first place. Mm-hmm. And so to have that kind of support. In fact, I hear he calls you cousin.
Yes. We are very close. And again, we... just a little offshoot. My maternal grandparents had three sets of twins, one boy, and a few years later, a set of twin girls, another few years later, another set of twin girls, and then 3 years later, another set of twin girls. And so Miles and Dorothy May, we call her Aunt Dorothy May, that's Vince's mom.
Right.
That's Miles' sister. They were best friends with the oldest set. Then the middle set, they were best friends with Vernon, who's his brother. And then my mother is one of the younger sets, and they just used to kind of hang out and try to follow the big kids along as they were coming. So we all grew up together, so we have a generational connection. And we just hosted Stanley Nelson, as many of you know, Birth of the Cool, the documentary, was released last year, and it's getting ready to come on American Masters, February 25th. So we hosted Stanley and the family back at the home in September. The beauty of that is that was the first time the family had been back since the house had been renovated. So it was a very, very moving experience and very emotional experience. And as we love to do in East St. Louis, we love to throw a big party. And we had a huge block party with ice cream trucks and Miles' favorite foods. Does anybody know what some of Miles' favorite foods are? Well, let me tell you a couple of foods. Just a couple of foods that you can only get in the East St. Louis area. Jack Salmon Fish was one of his favorites. He talks about it in his autobiography. That was his favorite fish, and it's similar to whiting. It's a long fish with one long bone, and you fry it, or either you can grill it or bake it. So, of course, we serve that. And snoots. Who knows what a snoot is? Anybody? Okay, you want to try? No.
Ha ha.
Miles had a whole lot of that. That's for sure. Snoot is a pig nose.
I was going to guess that.
It's a pig nose. And you serve it, you cut it, you grill it, and you have to really know what you're doing to cook a pig snoot.
Cook it right.
Some people call it pig snout. But at any rate, that was one of his favorite foods as well. So, of course, you can't have a party in East St. Louis without snoot. So we serve that. And one more food that Miles, when he first started to learn to cook, one of his favorite foods was chili mac. And the mac, anybody knows what makes it? Chili mac? You add spaghetti in the chili. So we serve that a lot as well with our party. So we have a lot of fun there. If you have ever visited or plan to visit, be prepared to have a good time at home. That's why we are H-O-M-E. Everybody comes there, feels like they're at home.
That's great.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Lauren. Mm-hmm. Lauren Parks, everyone. We have a very special treat now, which is a look at the construction, which, you know, obviously didn't have to be reconstructed, but the construction of the Rudy Van Gelder studio back in 1959, 1960. Maureen Sickler gets the credit for putting together this incredible photo montage, but it's Rudy himself who took all of these photos, monitoring the progress of how this incredible jazz shrine was put together. Thank you. Amazing. Maureen, thank you. I love how you got the band to end just in time. You know, that was great. Don?
Yes.
You know, and it's still in operation, right?
It's still in operation. We just did a session a couple of days ago, and we have another one on Tuesday coming up. And again, looking at the Van Gelder studio, this was what Rudy created in 1959. It was started in 58 and finished through the winters. You could see some snow there on the ground in some of the pictures. And the building was completed by the summer of 1959. And a lot of people get confused. I used to get confused, too, as to what really took place there. You have to do it by date. From 59 on, the summer on, it was done in Englewood Cliffs. When he recorded Miles, that was in Hackensack, his first studio. Gene, were you ever in Hackensack? You weren't in Hackensack. Gene Bertoncini is just waved at me when he came in. But he was in the Englewood Cliffs studio, that studio, quite a few times. And it looked a little different there, didn't it, in the picture.
If I could say one thing.
Sure.
Most of the recordings of Hubert Laws and Lalo Schifrin, a lot of great. And Rudy was friendly because I also have a degree in architecture.
Oh, really?
And so I got a job with David Henkin, and it lasted 8 days. Because I realized that I wasn't a great architect. I mean, I realized my gift was music, so I gave that up, and I went back into music and eventually got called to record with Hubert and Don Sobeski and Lalo Schifrin and a lot of wonderful recordings and Rudy was always very kind to me because of my connection with David Henkin, the architect, Frank Lloyd Wright and all that. I'm so proud that, so lucky that I got to work in that studio, Don and everybody here. And, so that's all I get to say.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you, Gene. Thank you. You know, to add to the story, of course, we have Jennifer Rothschild here, and she has some images to share with us. But David Henkin is a name that keeps getting mentioned. Perhaps we can start with that, and you can tell us about your role as well.
Well, if you want to put up the pictures, I will show you what he looks like. So this is a montage, and the reason why there are three pictures there is these are the three areas of historical significance that will be recognized when the application is submitted for the National Register. So in the corner, of course, you recognize John Coltrane. He recorded A Love Supreme. I have the date. Do you have the date, Don, offhand? So I think it was in the mid-60s, considered to be one of the best recordings in jazz in the entire genre, some people say. But I'm going to see if this works from here. Barely works. Up here, do you recognize the fellow in the hat?
Frank Lloyd Wright.
And yeah. to his left is David Henkin. David Henkin was a very interesting man. He was never an architect. He was a mechanical engineer. He was born in Brooklyn. He went to school in the city, and he just became infatuated with the idea of creating a cooperative community. Has anyone heard of Usonia? It's in Pleasantville, New York. Yes. So in order to get there, he wanted to study under Frank Lloyd Wright. Frank Lloyd Wright had introduced the idea of Usonian design, which was inexpensive housing, supposed to be suburban housing for the average American family. So he went up to Taliesin in Spring Green, Wisconsin, and he studied under Frank Lloyd Wright for at least a couple of years. His wife came with him. He met some other architects there, which became important for Van Gelder's studio because, as I told you, he was not a licensed architect, so he needed an architect to sign off, and the architect who signed off on the plans, and I didn't know this until I first went to the studio and looked at the plans, was a woman by the name of Eleanor Pedersen, also a Frank Lloyd Wright fellow, a licensed architect, the first woman architect to practice in New Jersey, and was head of the AIA, the American Institute of Architects, in New Jersey, the New Jersey chapter. So a very important person in her own right, but I digress. So the third photo, of course, is Rudy Van Gelder. So what are these significance areas? There are four areas of significance for the National Register. The Van Gelder Studio and Home meets three out of four, the first being association with historic events. That would be music. So John Coltrane represents that. But I want to point out that he's standing in front of the Van Gelder Studio. So there's a little architecture in that shot. That's a balustrade that's outside next to the studio door. You see a lot of that on album covers that were recorded at Van Gelder, you know, by Francis Wolfe and other great iconic jazz photographers. Second photo is Rudy Van Gelder. So association, that's criteria B, association with a famous person, a person of historical significance, Rudy Van Gelder. And third photo being David Henken, the third area of significance is the design of the building itself, which is a Wright-inspired Usonian building. Very interesting because it is a home and a studio. So we have here two homes. This is both. Rudy Van Gelder and his wife, he had wife Elva who passed away, and then his second wife lived in a two-bedroom, I guess you would call it an apartment, upstairs. So this was a house as well as a studio.
Do we want to show the images of...
Yes. I would love to show you more images. If anybody wants to see more images, I have my laptop here. But if you want to go to the next slide, I'll just tell you what these are. Okay, so this is great. In the process of getting something written up for the National Register is not just simply filling out a form. It's a very lengthy, scholarly process. We were very fortunate that Ashley Kahn himself has written a significant section of the application. We could not possibly have done it. He's just so knowledgeable. We also were lucky enough to have a professional photographer get involved, and that's a drone shot there of the studio. Do you see? If you look at it, you see these interesting geometric shapes, a very Wrightian thing. So you have the studio itself as a square. It's bisected by a rectangle, and at the end of the rectangle, you see that arrowhead pointing out. That's called a trellis in Wright terminology. It's purely decorative, no function whatsoever. It is... wood beams that are clad in copper. Now it's that beautiful verdigris color. All the colors being natural colors. And if you look at the lot, this is a Frank Lloyd Wright concept. It should have an acre of land. It should be very natural. This is a heavily wooded lot. Does anyone know Englewood Cliffs, New Jersey? That is just one commercial building after another after another. They're much higher than this one. This is just nestled in the woods. You can barely see it, and that's the way Rudy Van Gelder wanted it to be. So when I was fortunate enough to meet him on a Sunday afternoon, he made it very clear that he wasn't really entirely sold on this idea of listing this property. He didn't want any signs. I said, oh, no, you don't have to have a sign. But he just liked his privacy. He wanted to keep it real, you know, quiet. Unfortunately for the world, and I felt it very personally, even though I had only just met him, he died 4 days later on a Thursday. We met with him on a Sunday. So fortunately, though, for us and for the world, we have the Sicklers, who are very much interested in preserving this studio. So you should really clap for the Sicklers. I could go on and on and on, but I'm not going to.
Well, we will have more questions for you, Jennifer, but thank you so much for putting that all together. I am going to remind you guys that we want you to get involved and be part of the conversation, so that's why we have the microphone here in the center. I'm not going to wait for a Q&A section towards the end. I'm just going to continue the conversation up here, and if I see anyone approach the microphone, we'll call on you and have you join the conversation, as I said. One of the questions I definitely wanted to ask was, what were the biggest challenges that you guys faced in establishing these sites as a historical, gaining historical status, which is so important for the tax burden, et cetera, et cetera. And why don't we start with you, Ricky, and tell us when the decision was made to do the Louis Armstrong home and when it actually opened and when the first visitors came through.
Louis Armstrong passed away on July 6, 1971. I think Lucille had the idea on July 7th. It was that quick. There's actually there's a newspaper article from about 6 months after Lewis died where Lucille talks about how they used to talk about one day they would open up the house as a museum and people from all over the world would be able to see how Louis lived. That was in 71. We have a BBC interview that we sometimes play on tour from 74. And when she's talking about Louis's scrapbooks, how she has to get them restored because she says, I'm building a memorial museum. And then in 77, she had the house declared a National Historic Landmark. So this was all part of the plan. The clip of Louis and Lucille having that argument, which I won't quote it, but except for Louis, you know, he says, yeah, that's for posterity. So even he is thinking long term. I think both of them really were self-aware about how important Armstrong was, not just to jazz, but to the 20th century, and that one day people were going to be interested in how he lived. And, I mean, the man making these tapes, these scrapbooks, these manuscripts, you know, he was in charge of his own story. So Lucille never got rid of any of that. So she was full steam ahead. Her whole widowhood from 71 until 83 was devoted to Louis's legacy. But she did pass away suddenly in October 1983. And in her will, she left the house to the city of New York. The city of New York kicked it over to the Department of Cultural Affairs. They said, someone has to run this thing. And thankfully, Queens College stepped up. Queens College in Flushing, they were about 10 minutes away from the house. They had a burgeoning jazz program at the time with Donald Byrd and Jimmy Heath and Sir Roland Hanna. They were building Benjamin Rosenthal Library, which would be the perfect spot for the Armstrong archives. So a deal was made. The Louis Armstrong Educational Foundation, which is the Armstrong estate, they donated the archives to the college. And so that was step one. In 1991, 76 boxes of material was packed up from the Armstrong house. All of Louis's stuff, these tapes, these scrapbooks, all the archival materials was dumped off in Rosenthal Library. They hired an archivist at the time, Michael Cogswell. And that was Michael's first day on the job. There was the 76 boxes waiting for him. And
what year was that when Michael that started?
He was hired in July 91. So in September 91, they had a dedication. There had been already, they were on their second director of the Armstrong House, but the house was nowhere ready for the public. They were doing summer concerts. I should tell, this is kind of a beautiful story. Lucille had a housekeeper, Bessie Williams, who actually never met Louis. She was hired, I think, sometime in 72. And she continued going to the house after Lucille's death. And Queens College eventually put her on the payroll as well. So she continued the upkeep of the house like the Armstrongs were still living there. So the archives were phase one. They opened up to the public in May of 1994. And originally, I'll just talk about that for 2 seconds. That's kind of my domain. Originally, it was just Louis's stuff, which is incredible, but we made the decision to keep going. You know, our collection development policy is, as long as it's Armstrong, we are interested. And so flash forward today, we have 13 separate collections of all Armstrong material, making it the largest archives for a single jazz musician. And our archivist, Sarah Rose, is here. She's the one really kind of maintaining that. And thanks to a $2.7 million grant from Robert F. Smith, we digitized the entire archives. They're all available online. You go to collections.louisarmstronghouse.org. You can hear those tapes. You can look at the photos. It's unbelievable. So that's just the archives. Then Michael Cogswell was made director of the house in 95, and that was phase two. It was a $5 million restoration. Louis's garage was turned into a gift shop. The basement rec room was turned into an exhibit area. Lucille, in her widowhood, plopped kind of an illegal third floor on top of the house. And so Michael made the decision, let's get this house as close as we can to when Louis lived there. So the third floor was removed. And we were very lucky. No one's lived there since the Armstrong, so everything was 100% original. It was about a $5 million restoration. And then the house opened up in 2003. And then come along phase three, right around that time, we purchased an empty lot across the street from the Armstrong house with the plans of building an education center. And so the good news, I'm happy to report, we've raised $23 million. Construction's been ongoing for about, thank you. Construction's been ongoing for about a year and a half or so, about a year and a half. If all goes according to plan, I've been saying this for years, so don't hold me to it, but we could be in there in about a year or so, I would say. But the ultimate goal, where we're heading, is you'll come to 107th Street in Corona, Queens. You can take a tour of the Armstrong House, you know, everything as is. But the new center, the archives, which are at Queens College, will be the second floor. The first floor will be the exhibit area. It'll be a 70-seat jazz room, which we're naming after Lucille, where we'll have seminars and concerts and lectures and film screenings. It'll be interactive experiences. It'll be our little version of Graceland for Armstrong. And so all of this is happening full speed ahead. Challenges. Making it happen. Right. It ain't easy, but we're on our way.
That's amazing, Ricky. I can't get past that blue-hued kitchen.
Yeah, that
was what it was like originally.
We get people who visit the Armstrong House who aren't even big jazz fans. They just want to see a perfectly preserved late '60s house, and that kitchen. That's everyone's
that's
favorite.
That's amazing.
Room.
I think the message that really hits me is the whole sense of community the interaction between the Armstrongs when Louis and Lucille were alive, and even after, there's this sense that it had an important role, you know, within that part of Queens.
Corona, Queens is a working-class neighborhood. The demographics have changed over the years. When the Armstrongs moved in, it was Irish, Italian, African-American. When Louis died, it was predominantly African-American. Then it's gone through, Latin America. Now it's going through an Asian phase. But it's still always the same kind of working-class people. Those are the people Armstrong wanted to live around. And especially the neighborhood kids, they worshipped Louis and Lucille. And a lot of those kids have grown up, you know, they come to the house, they tell us stories. The neighbor, the Geraldo family, Selma Geraldo, I don't know if anyone ever had the chance to meet her, she was the neighbor who kind of ran the block until her passing in 2011. She left us her home in her will, so we used that for office space and everything. So, you know, the ties to the community are huge. We do a children's concert we've done since 1987, our longest running program called Pops is Tops. We do every spring just for the kids in the community, the Louis Armstrong schools. There's two schools named after Louis. You know, sometimes it's their first experience with live jazz. We've brought John Faddis, Roy Hargrove, you know, Alfonso Horn. And so, you know, it's all about about the community.
Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you, Ricky.
Thank you.
Lauren, I know that the whole sense of community, it's almost, you know, I don't need to state it. You know, it was there in your presentation and in the way you talk about the home thing. But what's most amazing, I guess, is just how fast you have really realized the vision of what the Miles Davis home should be. And, you know, what were the biggest challenges for you?
I think the biggest challenge is, of course, we are a 501c3, so everything is about raising money all the time. And so, as I initially stated, at the beginning of phase one, we used our personal funds, and then things started happening very quickly. Of course, since we have annual fundraisers, we have, of course, a website where people constantly donate and tours and things of that nature. So we continue to persevere. We have great news that we just received recently from the state of Illinois. We just received a $250,000 grant for capital improvements. So we are very, very thrilled. And so that's going to be a huge part of our phase two in our project. And we actually, when we get back, that's what I was working on earlier today, we have a seminar regarding more funding for the arts in the state of Illinois. So we have our state representative, Ms. Greenwood, and our state senator that are huge supporters and advocates.
Very important.
Yes, that is very important. So we... they are huge advocates for the arts. They actually brought the Illinois Arts Council to East St. Louis to see House of Miles East St. Louis, as well as other cultural arts facilities that we have in our wonderful community.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
We have a question.
Hi, my name is Sarah. I work at WBGO in Jazz Made America. I'm working on a story about St. Albans, Queens, where a lot of jazz musicians lived, as I'm sure you all know. And this might be a question for you, but sure. I was just wondering if you know of any efforts to preserve those houses. I know, like, there are people living there, so.
Right. I mean, I don't know of any efforts per se. there was something called the Queens Jazz Trail about 20 or so years ago, in which they had a map printed out. You can Google Queens Jazz Trail, and the trolley would take you around and all that. But Count Basie, Milt Hinton, they were all there. It's just unbelievable how many jazz musicians lived in Queens. But in terms of making them shrines or house museums, I haven't heard any word, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hmm. What's it called? Also, just wondering if, I don't know, if anyone's doing like research on the neighborhood, if there's any.
In Corona or just
anywhere?
Queens?
Yeah.
You want as Maxine? Well,
okay. All right. I'll talk to you, and I'll talk to you.
Right. There we go.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Maxine.
Yeah.
Very cool. Okay. I'm going to shift the focus again to Rudy Van Gelder's studio, which is very different. It's a commercial enterprise, an ongoing commercial enterprise, and is not in a community that is known for community. It's like you were talking about, a lot of commercial real estate surrounds it. So Don, what are the challenges as you guys move forward since Rudy's
passing,
et cetera?
Well, the most important thing to me, being a trumpet player and actually having gotten to play and record in that studio, is it's the most incredible acoustic space that I know of at all. In fact, we had Herbie Hancock out, who's a good friend, to have some pictures taken for this application for the National Landmark. And Jennifer happened to ask Herbie, she said, man, you must have played in, I hope I'm quoting you correctly, in practically every great recording studio in the world. I mean, how would you rank this studio? And he's standing out there and he said, first of all, he plays the piano. He said, listen to the sound of this room here. There's no room like that. And he says, besides, I get to play on this piano. I made all my records on this piano. This piano came from Hackensack, Rudy's first studio, and this was the piano that Bud Powell and Monk and everybody else played on, and it's still the major piano. We have a concert grand there, too, that Rudy got in 1992. That's another whole story I won't go into, but the other piano, the 7-foot Steinway, is the piano that, who hasn't played that piano? Most of the great jazz artists have recorded on that piano. So to me, the goal, and because it's such an incredible studio to play in, that it's just got to continue to be a recording studio. And in the acoustic world, that's what we're basically talking about. So that's the major goal, and so we're just, a lot of people, jazz artists who I've known for years, didn't even realize we were up and running and back recording again, and Maureen is doing the engineering, and everyone's very happy. It's just an incredible, incredible acoustic space to record in.
I guess the real question in trying to connect it with the other shrines that we're talking about is the idea that, you know, both the Louis Armstrong and Miles Davis homes were private locations that are now public. Is there going to be a public access aspect to in the
we
future?
Haven't done it. We haven't tried to become a nonprofit organization or anything yet. We're just still in this investigative stages of figuring out exactly what we're going to do. Right now, we're trying to just record, and, you know, artists like Ron Carter and, you know, very famous artists want to come out and record still in that studio. And so we're still exploring a lot of different possibilities. Yes, we want to bring some more educational school students to check out the studio. I have a lot of fun. For a while, we would be getting lots of emails, and people wanted to just show up at any time, and we've organized it into a few things, and I've enjoyed showing people the inside working of the studio and how it all worked. And again, I know Gene isn't left. I couldn't remember if the Hubert Laws date he was on was the first time I was at Rudy's, just as a spectator. But I'd been in the studio since the 70s, you know, and it's just, like I say, the most important thing to me is to keep giving musicians an opportunity to play in an unbelievable and record in an unbelievable space.
Jennifer, is that in any way, is that a positive or a hindrance to what the effort of getting historical status, that it's an ongoing commercial enterprise?
Oh, not at all, but the problem is the property taxes. If you're a nonprofit or municipal, owned by a municipal agency, you're probably not paying any property taxes. And do you want to tell them how much it is, Don?
No, I'm not going to tell you how much, but it's not. This is an acre of land in Englewood Cliffs, New Jersey. You look it up, that's one of the highest rated real estate taxes in maybe in the country, I don't know, and definitely in New Jersey. And it's a large thing that we've got to do to keep it going. So
just going back to that, getting onto the National Register does not create a public site. It is just a listed site. It can remain a privately owned entity. It does not require that it be open to the public. Now, people get that sort of mixed up. They think that immediately, once you're on the register, you will be tax exempt, you will be a public site. Those things do not automatically happen. You have to want that to happen. And the big advantage of being a nonprofit is that it would open to the public. It would also open up all kinds of grant opportunities. 501c3 is a term related to nonprofits under the Internal Revenue Code. And so there are many advantages to doing that, but it is by no means necessary. And in terms of the use, the best possible use of a historic property is as it has always been used. So to that, I commend the Sicklers.
Thank you. Katja.
Katja von Schüttenbach, jazz historian, and my question is about the other side of Rudy Van Gelder. I had an opportunity to see his studio right around his 89th birthday, I think, and I was astounded that he was an ornithologist, and he was an avid photographer of wildlife, especially birds, and he shared with us that he and his late wife had donated, I guess, a lot of money to maybe the Audubon Society to save areas where birds lived, I think, on Long Island. Is the artistic output, his output as a photographer, are there any plans to maybe come up with a book to raise funds for the house?
We would love to, yeah. We're not experts in that area, but Rudy was a master photographer, and again, he was a guy that did everything, every phase of the operation himself. He did not, just like recording, he had to mix and he had to master. He did, if you wanted Rudy, if anyone's going to make a mistake, he's going to make the mistake, and you're going to get the final project. And with his bird photography, he took all the pictures, he did all the prints. We still have all the print equipment upstairs, you know, digital printing, and he would pull all the proofs and discard the ones that he didn't like, and he was a master photographer, you know. And
do you have plans to have it professionally preserved and at a museum?
We would love to. If you're, we'd love to talk to anybody that's interested in that aspect. That's just, you know, he was a very creative man. We just found in the garage his Dr. Rudolf Van Gelder optometrist sign that sat in his studio. I had one of the guys who's helping us there has now build a frame and put it up, and it's in the back of the cove where he in the control room. Okay, so and so that's why it's. I just walked in there, and all of a sudden I see the sign lit up. Dr. Rudolf Van Gelder, optometrist. He was a man of detail. Obviously, he was trained as a optometrist. That's what he got his degree, but ever since he was a kid, and he discovered jazz, and then he would go to New York, and he would hear his great heroes, Coleman Hawkins, Johnny Hodges, Duke Ellington, and then he would buy the recordings of it. This is kind of what I got out of it from him, and he would listen to the recordings, and he would say, geez, I think you could record some of this better than what I've heard. So it just became something that was his lifelong mission to just try to record the individual musician, you know, the sound of the musician. Here he's going to Birdland, or he's going to whatever, he's hearing Coleman Hawkins live. He's hearing that. And then to just to be able to capture that essence of that musician and then mix it in with the other musicians, you know. So not just recording one musician. And that was really his genius of being able to take it and put the musicians all together and record it. And back, you know, until Gene got out there, in the multi-track era. Before that, everything was done two-track, you know. I mean, he had to set it up, and what you got is what you got. And he was the same way with photography. If you look at some of the favorites, if you were at Rudy's studio and if you walked in the control room, there's one recording of a hawk with a fish in its hand, okay? Mm. And Rudy said that bird was going about 40 miles an hour down the Hudson River, and he's got his lens like this, you know, he's got all this equipment, and he shot, and the bird is looking right at Rudy. It's like one of the most incredible pictures. It looks like it was posed, but it wasn't. It was just one of those shots, and Rudy was just, his coordination, you know, obviously he was a, being an optometrist, being everything else, and the musician, I mean, his ability, his detail was...
You probably could start licensing those.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's talk later.
Yeah. Katja, thank you for that question, because it brings up a similarity here between the Louis Armstrong house and Rudy Van Gelder, that there's actually an embarrassment of riches of stuff that both Louis and Rudy kept. They kept everything. And the idea of, you know, that's both great, but it takes time to process that. Uh-huh. And so thank you, Ricky, for your timeline, because it showed us, like, you know, how much thought and meticulous, you know, attention you guys put into that of information.
We have scrapbooks going back to 1925, when Louis and Lil Hardin Armstrong were in Chicago.
And I know Rudy has invoices going back to the 50s.
Yeah.
and his notebooks. And again, the tough part about Rudy is... two things, that his handwriting is very hard to read, and he scribbles in his notebooks, and Maureen has been able to decipher a lot of it. I've been able to decipher it. And, you know, he was so busy with doing his optometry business in Hackensack and then coming home at night and recording Miles Davis and Sonny Rollins and whatever else, and just little scratches. And, you know, we get to learn to, if it said Alfred, we knew that was Alfred Lyon. If it said Bob, it was Bob Weinstock, and, you know, and then we pieced together which session was done. It's a real puzzle. And again, I will say that one of the things that we in the industry use a lot is the Lord discography, which is a very good discography, but it's got lots of mistakes in it. And still to this date, many of the, if you Google and you try, you look in that discography, you get all of the list of records done at the Van Gelder studio, you'll be missing still a lot of them, still say New York on them. And that used to, when I first told Rudy about that, that drove him crazy. You know, he didn't like that. But Rudy was not the kind of guy that was going to go out, just like he didn't want to sign in front of his studio. He was about recording. That's what he was really about. Okay, I can go on forever. So you have a question?
Hi, Morgan Enos. I write for Jazz Times, Billboard, and Talkhouse on jazz-related subjects. But I recently moved from Queens to Hackensack, and I was sort of astounded to find out that the site of Rudy Van Gelder's parents' house is now a sports medicine clinic without any plaque in the front or anything. And while I'm aware that the vast majority of the great Rudy Van Gelder work was in Englewood Cliffs, I'm thinking that Blue Train and Saxophone Colossus were recorded in this place.
Years in from 53 to 59 in Hackensack was some unbelievable recordings, you know.
So I'm curious as to why it was never memorialized in any way.
Well, Rudy lost control of it, and you know, and it's a long story. But the building, Rudy was shocked when the building was torn down, and it, you know, it was a. The building was actually, you can see pictures of it on the internet. It's got a, looks very modern in itself, which has a white part in the front, which is really the living room area. By this time, when that house was built, I believe it was in 1949, is that right, Maureen? 46. Okay. So Rudy, he had already been doing some amateur recording and on his own. So when his parents built that house, they knew he was really interested in this, and they knew he had a lot of talent. So they purposely, although it was their living room, they constructed the living room with a higher ceiling and a larger space, so and a special area for a control room. Yes, it was their living room, and as a result, Rudy eventually had to get out of that environment because his parents wanted to go to bed at night, and the musicians, Alfred Lion, kept wanting to record later and later and later, and so that's why eventually he was going to have to move, and that's why he went to Englewood Cliffs. But did I answer your question?
You did, thank you.
Okay.
Hey, Napoleon.
Hey, how are you doing?
How are you, man?
Good, man, good. My name is Napoleon Revels, bass drummer, percussionist, and I talked to Ashley, and I'm going to thank everybody for what they're doing for the home, especially Don Sickler for helping out Ben Riley. You talked very highly of you, and Mr. Riccardi as well. So I'm with the Coltrane home, and they're not here, and I just happened to tell Ashley. So he said, well, you going to say anything about the home? I could say, so, you know, in 1964, that's what Train recorded, he got the idea for Love Supreme. And they stayed there for about 3 years.
And we're talking about the Coltrane home out on Long
right,
Island.
Yeah, that should be the Coltrane home on Long Hills. Island, yeah. Not right. The one in Queens. That's on Mexico, I think. Mexico.
Or the one in Philadelphia.
Yeah, or the one in Philadelphia. Right. So they just got their designation, too, because I was here when when Washington came up and gave them their designations. So right now, I'm on the educational side, so we do the summer workshops. They've had the John Coltrane Jazz Festival out in Huntington. So I don't know who's going to be featured this year, but me and a few other the musicians have been doing the educational tip where the children come out and we doing the libraries and things of that nature. So I'm hoping that next year, you know, maybe the Coltrane home will be here. Ravi's back on the staff, and Kathleen Hennessy is part of it too. And so hopefully, if you want to know anything more about it, you can talk to me. And, you know, we're always looking for volunteers to go out to the house. The house is being cleared up right now. No one can really go in there yet. It's still good, but they got the most of the mold out, and you can see the room where the idea for Love Supreme came, and where Alice has also recorded downstairs in the basement, so you can see that room, and they got plaques up and stuff like that. So it's still functional. So we welcome everybody to come out, and I'm not official spokesman, it's just I happen to be here, so I said, okay, I'll say something about the coaching. But I'm honored to be a part of it, and I hope, especially musicians, you need to be a part of this stuff. You really need to, because that's touching your ancient forefathers, you know, being the Coltrane house and working with Miles Davis or whatever. So thank you so much for inviting. So great. Thank you.
Thank you, Napoleon. Thank you.
Somebody told me you might have had something to ask me, Don, before. Otherwise, I have a few little details.
Okay, go ahead.
Whenever I went to the studio, you talk about his gloves. He always wore gloves and wouldn't let anybody touch anything. And he had two pianos. You rehearsed on one piano, and then you did the take on another piano. I did a couple of albums there with Roger Kellaway, and also the tremendous variances in the sizes of the orchestra or the. One album, you know, was a quartet, a trio, but then he also had a great album with Ahmad Jamal with a huge band called Macanudo, and he was able to handle all himself. He'd mic everything
Right, in the 60s, the only picture that Rudy took that I found that he took in the studio, he took two pictures and put them together. It's Bill Evans with full symphony orchestra, and that's before the booze were in there. So every microphone he moved, nobody touched anything. That was and he always had two pianos. When you were out there, that would have been two Bs, two seven-foot Steinways, and one of them, he always wanted the piano in tune, you know. So if you're going to record, if you're ready to record and just go boom, 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 you sit at one piano. But if you're going to rehearse at all, go to the other piano and rehearse. And then when you're ready, go to the other piano and record.
And he had Ron Carter's sound.
Yeah, oh yeah. And again, with those musicians like Ron Carter, Ron used to, every time, this was back in the days of the pickups for the bass, and every time Ron would get a new pickup, he'd go out to Rudy's on the weekend and bring the new pickup, and they'd look at it and see if this is really what they want, and, you know.
Sorry about this.
No. You know, yay.
Yeah, so it's
that's Rudy.
And Rudy wore everybody. The idea of the glove thing is Rudy wore gloves just to keep the one handling microphones and you know to keep his hands clean and to keep everything else clean. But there's a lot of wild stories of him wearing gloves for this and that, and you know I don't buy most of it. And Rudy said I just, you know, would put on the gloves when I'm going to be touching microphones.
And it was so great that he chose a great architect to work with, come up with a beautiful.
Well, he loved you. He loved you. This is one of the great acoustic and electric guitar players of all time right here, Gene Burton. And that's what Rudy did. Rudy was there to record the artist. When Gene plays, he's going to approach it. He's trying to get Gene. You know, that's the secret of Van Gelder. He went for the artist. It's not the, oh, here's a guitarist. I'll give you the quote-unquote guitar sound. He's saying, let me see how Gene is really approaching this thing, and that's what he's trying to do. Same way with trumpet players. All of the J.J. Johnson, all of the guys, Freddie Hubbard, they would always tell me that what I liked about Rudy's is he always got my sound. Yeah. You know, that's what, he'd walk out in the room when an artist is playing, and he's checking it out, deciding which microphone. You didn't ask him any questions. Just, if you didn't like something, talking English, and he'd listen to what anybody said. A lot of people felt
hey, Don, I'm going to interrupt because we've got about 5 minutes left.
Sure.
And I'm going to shift the focus right back to the idea of the shrines again.
Sure.
Because I do have one question that I want to make sure I ask all you guys. I'm sure you've all seen Field of Dreams with Kevin Costner, and that voice comes out of the corn and says, you know, if you build it, they will come, you know, and that's both a good thing and sort of a scary thing, I think. And having Napoleon talk about the Coltrane home way out in the eastern part of Long Island, these are not shrines that are necessarily located in, like, you know, areas where you would put a museum or whatever. And I'm just wondering, let's start with you, Ricky, because I know you have another panel real fast.
Yeah, I'm heading to the Appel room, so follow me when we're done here.
Right, but that part of Queens, any challenges with being there?
Yeah, we're here in Manhattan. Going to Queens is like going to Siberia for a lot of people. So that is a major challenge. It's funny, we probably get international visitors on a daily basis. We're near the airport, so people coming and going visit all the time. But I give a lot of lectures in Jazz Museum of Harlem, Jazz Lincoln Center, and I ask if people have gone to the Armstrong House, and there's something daunting about Queens that, you know. Right. So we're optimistic that when the new building's open and we have more programming and you can really make a day of it, you know, because we get about 16,000 people a year, but really school groups kind of keep it going. We get school groups every day, two groups a day, and so, you know, we're lucky in that. And I still think that interest in Armstrong is still early. I think it's only going to keep rising, especially as the new center opens. So I think the best is yet to come, but I got to run. So
Thank you. And
I
Lauren?
Just want to say I went there on Sunday to the Louis Armstrong House, and I got a parking spot right across the street. No problem.
There you go. So you don't only have to take the 7 train. Lauren, would you like to talk about
Yes, that? Well, we are in the mighty Midwest. We are in East St. Louis, Illinois. It is different from St. Louis. St. Louis is in the state of Missouri. East St. Louis is in the state of Illinois, so the mighty, muddy Mississippi River separates the two. We were told there was another entity interested in the property, and if they had acquired the property, they did plan to move the property because it was in East St. Louis, Illinois. So House of Miles East St. Louis, Mr. Pearson and myself, we were very honored to acquire the property, we said absolutely not. Miles Davis grew up in East St. Louis, Illinois. He grew up on 17th and Kansas Avenue in that structure that sits there today. So we are very proud to be products of East St. Louis, Illinois. We are very proud to have that. There are two museums in East St. Louis, Illinois. We are one of two. We are officially listed in the Illinois State Tourism Bureau booklet. We're very proud of that fact. We, too, have visitors from all over the country and all over the world daily that come to East St. Louis, Illinois, that sits on 17th and Kansas Avenue. So the I guess the challenge and the question that you have, of course, if you research East St. Louis, Illinois, we get a bad rap on a lot of things. We do have our challenges, but we also are the city of champions, and we're very proud of that fact. We are champions in many, many areas, arts and culture, government, athletics, et cetera, et cetera. So we've overcome that challenge because they keep coming, as you just said. If they build it, they'll come, and they do. And we encourage everyone here. I have information about House of Miles East St. Louis. Please take these with you. Please check out our website. Please, please, please come visit. We'd love to have you.
Any last words, Don, Jennifer, about the location of, you know?
Well, the Van Gelder studio, a lot of, when I first went out there, it seemed like it was a long ways away from Midtown where I was living. But actually, now that we make it on a, we live on 28th Street in the Chelsea area of New York, and we go out there, it's really public transportation to the, all the way, take the A train through Sugar Hill and Harlem to 175th Street, and you get on a bus, and it takes you right there to Rudy's. And if you're driving across the bridge with me, I'll say, see that building right there? That Rudy's is right behind that. It's very close to the city. And that's why Alfred Lion and all of the New York companies went out there to record. It's closer than Hackensack is to where they used to go before Rudy built this studio in 1559. So it's easy access to me from the city.
And Jennifer, anything you'd like to add about the location?
Well, I do believe he wanted it to be as close to the city as possible while still remaining in New Jersey. So he certainly accomplished that. I will say that, never mind. You're at the end of your time here, so I won't go on. But any other questions? I don't know. You know, when you get something listed on the National Register, there's a lovely, tasteful, small bronze plaque.
We got Rudy to
make the Louis Armstrong House.
It's on Route 9W is the street, or it's called Sylvan Avenue. We got Rudy to make the sign a little bit. The sign used to be 445 was this big when I first went out there. And musicians would call up, I'm lost. How do I find the street? Now the sign's about this big. 445, but when you come to it, you say this can't be it because it's just a driveway and you don't see anything except now when there's no leaves on the trees, you can see a building. But it's like driving into the forest, and the musicians love that. The fact that you grow up in New York and you come out there to record, and it's like you're out in the woods. So it had a really pleasing, right, Gina? It had a real pleasing environment to just be in this room and record. And Rudy was the guy to do it, you know?
Yeah, I was just looking at Temples of Sound. It's a great book about great recording studios. And there was a great photograph in the backyard at the Van Gelder studio of John Coltrane and some of the other musicians just hanging out, taking a lunch break in that shady, wooded backyard.
Guys, we're out of time. I just want to thank our panelists, Lauren, Jennifer, Don, of course, Ricky, Maureen for being here, Napoleon, thank you, Jazz, and thank you all for your attention and your love of jazz. If I don't see you, we'll see you at next Jazz Congress anyway, and see you around. Thank you again.
And thank you, Ashley, for inviting us.